Okay, welcome all. Whatever the clock says, it's wrong, so it's actually after seven, so we're gonna start the meeting. Welcome to the Harwich Zoning Board of Appeals meeting for Thursday, April 6, 2016, at 7 p.m.
Typo.
Typo. No, it's April 6. Tonight's April 6.
2017.
Seventeen.
Oh, 2017, I'm sorry. Yes, a typo. Never could proofread. Okay, this is the Harwich Zoning Board of Appeals, our public hearing here in the Griffin Meeting Room at Harwich Town Hall, 732 Main Street, Harwich, Mass., 02645. This hearing has been continued from March 8, 2017, and March 21, 2017, and also March 23, 2017. It relates to a comprehensive permit application for the property located at 9397 Route 28 in West Harwich, Assessor's Map Number 10, Parcels Number W3B and W5. And I want to let everyone know we are gonna be video recorded, and if you wanna take a look tomorrow, if you're gonna speak, or I don't know, maybe the next day, I don't know how soon they do it, you can go onto the town website and click on Channel 18, and you'll get a link to YouTube, and this hearing will be posted on YouTube. I'm gonna ask the members of the board to introduce themselves, please.
Kathleen Muller.
Dean Hedersted.
Dave Ryer.
John Burke.
Franco Previn.
And Shayla Delaney, Secretary.
Okay, these five members are our regular members, and they are the voting members on this case. I will now ask Mr. Burke, our clerk, to read in the case, please.
Okay, this is case number 2017-04, Habitat for Humanity of Cape Cod, Inc. Care of attorney Warren H. Brody has made an application for a comprehensive permit pursuant to MGL Chapter 40B, Sections 20 through 23 and 760 CMR 56 to create an eight-lot subdivision to provide six new single-family affordable homes, two market-rate lots, and a cul-de-sac. The property is located at 93 and 97 Route 28, Harwich, Assessor's Map 10, Parcels W3B and W5, located in the RL Zoning District.
And we have the applicant in front of us. I'm going to ask them to identify themselves, please.
Thank you very much. Lee Darazola here on behalf of Habitat for Humanity of Cape Cod. I'm in land acquisition and permitting as a project manager. We also have Craig Ferrari from Down Cape Engineering in the audience, Vicki Goldsmith, our executive director, and Hetch, various members, as well as their attorney, Andrew Singer. I would like to extend our apologies. Our attorney, Warren Brody, could not make it tonight. He's been off Cape with other business. I am stepping in as project manager, not as attorney. He and I have discussed it. There's also Hetch's attorney here, and Habitat is fully aware that I am representing the project as a project manager. So just a caveat there and apologies from Warren. We just didn't want to continue again.
Okay, fair enough. I think where we left it last time, there were a number of items for the applicant to address.
Yes, I have provided some rather hefty packets. I'm just going to summarize what is in them. Obviously, there's not time to have read them. We did not expect that. I also provided some for the audience, and Sheila will have the electronic copies tomorrow morning. What is in that packet, and I'll review them, and then I think the main issue we want to start with will likely be site control. But what is in that packet is a purchase and sale document, also homeowner association documents. There's two different documents, a declaration of trust and a declaration of easements. Those are samples. They're drafts. Typically, I'll get into details of all of these as we go, and also the Conservation Commission filing that this board had requested a copy of. So that is what is in the packets. I have a list of information that you'd asked for, but to start with the site control, the purchase and sale that we have submitted is between Habitat and Hetch, and it covers the entire site, all of 93 and all of 97. It does have in the purchase and sale that we will be conveying back to them lots 7 and 8. which are the front lots that will then be smaller. And I actually, at this point, want to take a step back and talk a little bit about the history of this project. Because as I was putting this together, I outlined how we had gotten to where we are. And I think that might be very helpful to this group. Originally, Hetch had approached Habitat, asked us if we wanted to buy these properties. And we looked at them. We had a site task force. We thought it would be great. We thought it would, you know, honor Bob Murray's memory. We looked at the existing structures, and we said, okay, we'll demo those. They did not seem like they were in good shape to us. They didn't fit our model. At that point, we hadn't gone in and examined them, but that's what we were thinking of. We had preliminary meetings with the town and with some folks in the neighborhood, and we realized, we were told that there was significant interest, especially in the Chase home. So that's when we came up with this more complex, but we thought on a path to sort of get to everyone's goals of, okay, instead of tearing them down, we'll use 40B to carve this up differently, and then these homes can be preserved. So the complexity came sort of at the request and working with the town and the neighbors. So what we have now is the purchase and sale for the entire property. And yes, you know, we are going to carve it up into 8 lots and sell back or convey back lots 7 and 8. There was talk as we sort of went through this process. It's like, well, could we, you know, convey them to a third party? And then it wouldn't seem like we were just conveying them back to Hetch. But that had been the idea all the time, is that that's what we would do. It is site control. You know, like I said, we have the purchase and sale, and that's actually our project eligibility letter in speaking to Warren. That is determinative on site control. But we can definitely restructure it to make it work for everybody. So we have the purchase and sale. So I guess I'd sort of ask for more questions about that. But the complex structure came to try to help save those buildings, which was what we heard the community wanted.
I'm sorry, you're waiting for us?
Are there any questions about site control?
Yes. I have significant questions.
Okay.
Let me see if I can summarize this in quick phraseology. You're going with 8 units. You are going to call those yours under affordable housing. You're asking us to agree to that.
6 units.
Once we do that, they're under your control.
Okay.
But you're not going to keep that under your control like you are 6. You're going to give 8 back.
Okay.
Now let me ask you a question. We're giving you those 8 units to control. Mm-hmm. We would assume that you would take 2 units that you have existing there and convert them to affordable houses, because you're asking us to agree under the Affordable Care Act that that's where they would be. So those units, if you will, you call them units, it could be apartments, whatever they are,
okay,
those could be affordable units and keep them that way. Then you don't get rid of them. But no, you want to sell them, you want to give them back, and you get rid of control, yet you've processed everything through us as Affordable Care Act pieces of property, but you don't retain it. The town doesn't get the benefit, but we give you that benefit, but we don't keep it. The town doesn't keep it.
Okay.
So my question is, why are you doing that? Why not just keep them and keep the units as affordable and keep them in perpetuity and let it go with that and pay whatever it costs for whatever has paid for those units? You're going to take control of them. You take control forever, not piecemeal. I'll end. Stop.
Okay. Let me try to answer that. And Andrew, if you want to step in. The Mass General Law Chapter 40B requirement for affordable housing is 25%. So a conventional for-profit developer might do, you know, four units. One unit would be affordable and three units would be market rate. There's no requirement to do all of the units market rate. We are terming the front, the existing structures, we're calling them market rate. You know, they are actually likely year-round rentals and probably affordable, but they're technically market rate. We could have torn those down. We could build new in there and sell those market rate. There's not a requirement that we do 100% of the development as affordable. This is the way, I hear Andrew coming to help me, thank you.
Keep going.
Oh, it's just, I mean, that's the law, is that there's a certain percentage affordable and a certain percentage market. So, you know, whether we're going to sell them all, the units eventually, regardless.
You're going to sell them, but not as affordable. And that's what I was
exactly.
driving at.
Exactly. And we're doing six Habitat back homes. A new construction, sweat equity build, are going to be under the Habitat program. Those will all be deed restricted affordable. And then the newly created lots 7 and 8 are going to be our market rate lots. And
okay.
They will not be.
I understand. What you're trying to get across to us,
yes.
I think, is something that I think we've been all wrestling with. The issue of this particular agreement gives you status that you would not normally get any other way in the town. And you are asking us to take that status and provide it to two other locations, but not... but then give it back. In the meantime, we've given it all, the town has given it all, and we don't get the benefit. And what the benefit being, you've got units in there that we could convert to affordable housing. We've given you all the benefits of the town, giving you all of the waivers, et cetera, for affordable housing, yet we've got two units on Main Street that are not going to be considered affordable housing, that are not going to give any benefits to this town.
Well,
and my only concern is how do we approach the people in this town and give them assurances that we're doing it correctly?
I would say that, you know, we are far exceeding the requirement of 25%. We are doing fully 50% of the units affordable, and whether we sell the market rate units tomorrow, 10 years from now, there's not a requirement that those be affordable. We're doing already significantly more than the minimum requirement of affordable. And if the entire project were to be affordable, I mean, that changes the pro formas that potentially could make it uneconomic. I mean, we haven't analyzed that part of it. The concept is that the market rates are used to subsidize and allow the creation of the affordables. And that's the way 40B works.
So does it become an affordability issue, basically? Is that what it comes down to?
There are multiple issues. We originally thought about demolishing and building a whole Habitat neighborhood. And we came up with a structure based on communication with the town and the neighbors, that those units had value and that the town and the neighbors wanted, especially the Chase one, wanted that saved. So that's how we came up with the structure. I think Andrew's been waiting very patiently. I'd love to have him come in here.
Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No problem. For the record, Andrew Singer, the attorney on behalf of Harwich Ecumenical Council for the Homeless, the current owner of the property. Following up on what Ladara said, and Dean, try to get to your point and some of the comments that came from the last meeting. I think the struggle that the board is going through is the uniqueness of the fact that we have these three structures, two houses and a barn, that are trying to be saved. So what I wanted to ask you to do for a second is to back up and think of a hypothetical. assume that these lots that you have right here, 93 and 97, they're there today and they're vacant, completely vacant. Chase House was never built. So you have a vacant parcel of land that was never developed in the town of Harwich. Habitat comes in with a 12-lot subdivision. Bob Murray was thinking of 20-plus, but Habitat comes in with a 12-lot subdivision. Hetch sells them the land. They propose a plan to you that they are creating a 12-lot, 12-house, single-family dwelling subdivision. 25% of it, 50% of it will be affordable. Six of the units will be affordable. Six of them will be market rate. This is the hypothetical, vacant piece of land. I've done 40Bs with you before. I know you've looked at 40Bs before. So you have a 12-lot subdivision, half affordable, and the market rate houses, as Ladara said, would subsidize the affordable housing. Would you have the questions that you have about site control? Because what Habitat would be doing is they would build the 12 houses, they would sell the 12 houses. Six of those houses would be market rate units that could sell for whatever the market would bear, and six of those houses would be deed restricted permanently as affordable. If the board would have no concerns with that kind of a development, which frankly to me seems like a very typical, straightforward 40B development, that is the development you have in front of you, with the twist that the parties, in response to town and neighbor concerns and comments, are trying to save the structures. That's the complexity. It is, several people have said, if we just wipe out the buildings and redevelop the property, I don't think there's any issues of site control. I don't think there's any concerns about the benefit the town's getting. The benefit that the town gets on a for sale 40B is that you get to count the deed-restricted affordable units towards the town's subsidized housing inventory for purposes of meeting the 10% goal that the state sets. The proposal that Ladara has before you for Habitat is going to result in 12 units on this land. Three in one house, one in a barn, two in a house, market rate, and then six affordable houses in the back. You will have six deed-restricted affordable houses, 50% of the 12, that will count towards this town's subsidized housing inventory. That's the exact same benefit that the town would get if this was vacant land and they were building 12 houses.
In that case, Attorney Singer, you say, would we have any questions? Yeah. Possibly not about site control, because it would be cleaner.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a rather intricate little proposal you've put in front of us.
We don't deny that.
Okay. I would have some questions about 12 units going in on less than 90,000 square feet, in which case they would average less than 8,000 square feet apiece. Mm-hmm. I would have questions about 12 septic systems. Mm-hmm. I would have questions about 12 houses issuing traffic onto Route 28 from a pretty tight spot in a very congested location. All the questions, apart from site control, all the other questions that were raised, I think, would remain, and some new questions were raised in a letter that we received recently that I'd like to hear addressed as well.
But let's stick with site control for the moment, if we may.
Okay.
I appreciate that. I understand that, but I think we need to nail down site control. The public is going to wait until the board is done. Thank you.
From a site control standpoint of view, How long does Habitat for Humanity keep control of the sites for lots 7 and 8?
There is no requirement for a year, for 2 years, for a minute, for 2 minutes. That's not part of the regulations. That's not part of the 40B process. There's no, we have to hold on to it for a certain amount of time.
And if I might, well, Adara says absolutely correct, but let me also point out here that there's even more complexity, which is actually a benefit to the town. You said what happens to the six units in the front two properties on lots 7 and 8. Hetch has, fortunately, been able to find a buyer who wants to take both of those properties and maintain the rental housing. And that rental housing, you all know the area, you know the size of the units. They're not going to be deed restricted. Those are going to be the market rate properties, but those rentals that are going to continue are going to be what I call little A affordable rentals. They're not going to be big A deed restricted as Ladara is talking about, but they're still going to be affordable rentals or rentals on those properties. And so housing is going to remain on the site. So I just wanted to throw that out in addition to what Ladara was saying about site control is a function of what the Commonwealth states under the project eligibility letter. On a for sale project, the developer is typically going to sell those, all the units, but they're going to sell the market rate ones as well, and they're going to sell them to whomever they're going to sell them, and they're going to sell them whenever they can sell them. So site control is a function of what's before you today during the comprehensive permit hearing process. It always envisions for a for sale development that they're going to be sold.
Understand.
Any comments, Mr. Burke?
I just have a couple of questions. First, thank you for all the additional information. I have not digested this, and I will, but I just have a couple of questions that you could answer so that when I'm looking them over, I can. First of all, the new purchase and sale agreement, this is being substituted in your application for the original one that was submitted. Is that correct?
Correct.
We have a letter to that effect that this now becomes a substitute for, I believe it was Exhibit P.
Yes.
Now, are you also withdrawing the site control agreement?
Yes.
Would you confirm that in writing too? So we know exactly what the record is in front of us as we review this. So we will now review this purchase and sale agreement in the place of those two prior documents.
Correct.
Okay, good. Second question is now the new agreement I've just looked at quickly, the purchase price is the same as the old agreement.
Correct.
However, there are six lots covered under the new agreement, eight lots under the new agreement, the entire property, as opposed to six in the prior agreement.
Correct.
Okay, so you're not paying any more money for this.
Correct.
And then if I read paragraph five of this, it says that in addition to the cash payment, which is the same for a different amount of property, that there is a requirement here that immediately following the conveyance of the premises to the buyer, which would be Habitat, the buyer shall convey 7 and 8 back to the seller for $1.
Correct.
All right. Are there any other changes in this agreement other than essentially that? I haven't read it yet.
Those are the changes that I believe are pertinent to the board and to site control.
Okay. Does this document now represent the entire understanding regarding the purchase and sale of the property between Heck and?
I believe so, yes.
Could you confirm that with you when you put that in? Okay, we want to make sure we got the entire record here. Are there any other documents, agreements that involve that? We should have it in front of us to make sure we understand what you're proposing to tell us constitutes site control.
Deleting it.
Okay, that's all I have now. I don't want to delve deeper into this till I see all the
documentation. Yeah, I haven't read it, looked at it. So
you could supply that to us in short form, that would be helpful.
Right, we're going to reserve comment on the documents and the structure. I appreciate the comments that were expressed by you and by Attorney Singer on site control.
That's all I have on site control.
Understand the concept. I guess it still kind of looks like a shell game. I'm sorry with the, you know, immediately upon closing, it goes right back. That I don't know. It just doesn't pass the smell test. I'm sorry, but maybe it's okay. I don't know. I need to think about it a little bit and review the documents, as we all will. Yes, Mr. Previn.
Please, thank you. I have a question regarding once lot 7 and 8 are separated from the six units to be developed. We're in the RH zoning, is that correct? The district?
It's in two districts, actually. But I don't know where it divides.
Okay, but anyway, I would like to have an answer or an understanding of the question.
Well,
if once the two lots are separated, the actual development will actually be done under the 40B process.
Correct.
Once the two units are separated now we're having two units, two individual lots, mm-hmm. which have a multi-family situation, which are really no longer under the 40B process.
Well, they are under the 40B process because
they will be developed under the 40B process, but once separated, they really don't make the zoning regulations.
That is true because they are created under the 40B just as if there was a 12-unit single-family home.
Yeah.
All 12 units, now if it was acre zoning, now they're all on quarter acres, so they don't conform to zoning, but they are created by the comprehensive permit. If changes were to happen, a owner would have to come before the zoning board for an amendment to the comprehensive permit, whether it's the market rate home that's on the 10,000 square foot lot or the affordable home.
Mm-hmm.
So none of the lots in our hypothetical 12 home subdivision, they no longer conform to what had been underlying zoning because they were all created within the comprehensive permit. They are all controlled by the comprehensive permit. The affordable ones have the extra deed rider on them, but none of them meet what used to be zoning. They're all on their 10,000 square foot lots.
Right, what we're gonna be doing if this permit is approved is we're gonna be creating eight non-conforming lots.
I understand, but
that's what they're asking for.
But yeah. Once the process is done, the development is completed, two of those lots now will be released from this so-called process.
They actually,
Well, they all will be once they pass to the buyer, but they will have deed restrictions on them.
That is correct, but they're individual units, whereas now we've got multifamily units on the same configurations as the individual units.
They will always be controlled by the comprehensive permit. All, again, either the eight lots we're proposing or in our hypothetical, which I think is easier to think about the hypothetical because it doesn't involve existing and rehabilitation. So the 12 homes, the six of them that are deed restricted have the deed rider and the comprehensive permit. The six of them that are market rate are still part of that comprehensive permit and could have conditions. I mean,
do you control them? Once you get rid of the two, do you still control them?
The zoning board controls them. The comprehensive permit is on record, and it's a permit issued by this board. If a market rate homeowner of a three-bedroom home wanted to add a garage and an accessory apartment, they would have to come before this board. If in the comprehensive permit you had said one house per lot, no garages, no accessory apartments, they might come and ask for it, and you might say no. The comprehensive permit says no.
I have worked up like 25 conditions that I'd like to go through tonight, and I think we can address some of these in the conditions. I'm not sure you're going to like them all, but we're going to talk about them, I think.
May I ask one more question about site control?
Sure.
I think you mentioned at the last meeting that you had an interested buyer and you referenced that this evening. Why in that case is HESH involved and Habitat for Humanity? Why has the other buyer not, why have you not come to the town and with the prospective buyer and said, this is what we'd like to do? This party remains anonymous to us, and yet apparently if this were to go forward, that party would take ownership of those two then substandard size lots.
I'll start by answering, and then I'll also ask Andrew on behalf of Hetch, because I think it's both a Habitat and a Hetch answer. One of the reasons is we wanted to be very, very transparent with this board. I mean, this was the original idea, was that, okay, we're going to create eight lots, two of them go back to Hetch. Hetch's buyer came into the landscape after we had made this agreement and came up with this project concept. So that really was the original concept, and we didn't want to, I guess I'm hearing some feelings that this is a little bit of a shell game, but we wanted to be as clean and clear as possible. These were Hetch homes. They have Hetch tenants. Habitat is not a rental organization. Hetch and Habitat are both mission-driven housing nonprofits, but we are ownership. And Hetch, it was Hetch that made an agreement, and I'll let Andrew speak, but it was Hetch's agreement with the town and promises with the town about the historic home. So that's why we thought it was best to let Hetch keep that.
And to follow up on that, the lot 7 and 8, when you create them, are going to be lot 7 and 8. 4 units on lot 7, 2 units on lot 8, subject to David's 25 conditions. And no matter who owns them, they're going to be subject to that. If this buyer goes away, Hetch owns it. Hetch, and as Ladara said, that's what was the original proposal. Hetch is a rental organization. They have their 5 tenants now, and there will be 6 tenants upon what we're seeking approval for, what Habitat's seeking approval for. And those lots, no matter who owns them, again, they're market rate lots, so no matter who owns them, they're going to be subject to whatever the conditions are. We're telling you that they're going to be used for housing because there are apartments there, and that's what everybody wants to continue on those lots. But so it's really, as Ladara said, we're trying to be upfront with everybody. It's not a shell game, but the complexity, and Ladara and I have spoken about this, the complexity of trying to save these two structures is what's driving all the angst. And the structures that are there, historical, there are many in town who want them to be preserved, they're not in good shape. It's going to take a lot of money to rehab those structures. It would be much more cost effective to just level them and to start over and to still have the same type of housing, because then you've got new structures, you don't have mold issues, you don't have all these other things that have to be remedied in the structures. So the complexity is because everybody is trying to preserve the historic structures. There is no legal requirement to preserve those structures. They can be taken down tomorrow. And so, but what everyone's trying to do is protect them. And unfortunately, it's leading to, a lot of the questions and concerns at this threshold level. You're not even getting to your questions about density and traffic and other things, which will be part of your review. But at this threshold level, that is what I think is causing all of this conversation. I would reiterate that I think what is before you is exactly what could be done under a more conventional 40B where the structures aren't being preserved. And if we can get over that hurdle and say we're doing the same thing that we could otherwise do, but we're, hey, added benefit, we're saving historical structures, then I think maybe we can hopefully get to the more substantive comments and questions that I know many of you have.
I just I didn't mean to be flip by saying shell gamer doesn't pass the smell test, but it really in substance isn't much different from the prior MOU, and it's sort of minimal site control. I mean, you have it for 1 second and then it goes away, and I understand the desire to preserve the existing structures. It is not like a regular normal 40B, though, where the applicant would acquire the property and then sell off unrelated parties, not back to their seller, the market rate units or lots.
Can I ask a question of the board? Sorry, it's okay to jump. Can I ask a question of the board? If this application goes away and a new application comes in for an 8-lot subdivision with 6 single family houses on 6 lots, a duplex on 1 lot, and 4 units on another lot, it's the same thing. And it's going to be sold still. So I'm having trouble. I understand why it's complex, but it's the same thing in substance at the end of the day.
And if I could add,
it probably is in substance at the end
not,
of the day.
It's not.
Well,
you got 12.
We shouldn't be answering hypothetical questions.
Yeah, we shouldn't be answering. Yeah, okay.
If I
could add something very real and non-hypothetical, and Dan Orgila from Downkeep Engineering, you're getting double the amount of affordable from a normal 40B. So, we never lose sight of the fact that even, if something is slightly irregular, you're getting twice the affordable that any other for-profit developer would get.
We did the math. We know.
Yeah. Well, it's not a small amount, double. Right. It's 6 instead of 3. Anybody else could come in here with 3 and make a good money, and this is, you're getting twice that. So it's okay. could cover some sins.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Burke.
Yeah, just to go back to on the site control issue too, your application, if you could confirm this to us, in the prior hearing you represented that there'd be no work done on the market rate units on the two front lots, essentially staying the way they are, right?
Habitat will be working on the back six lots. Hetch or Hetch's new owner would...
The applicant, you're the applicant. Are you going to be doing anything to the front units?
No.
No, okay. If you could confirm that, because now you're going to have some interval of ownership. So you could just confirm that that's your intention. The other thing is, I would suggest you might want to review your application form and perhaps submit an amended one, because there are a number of different things that your proposal has now changed in that you have not, I've not seen anything for. For instance, dimension of the entire comprehensive permit is now not correct. You now have a basis of control that is new. It says, did or will the applicant gain control of the site to an arm's length transaction? And you say, yes. Well, I'm not sure that your new purchase and sale agreement, do you want to reconfirm that that's an arm's length transaction? And then it goes on, will any previous owner of the property have a financial interest or benefit from the comprehensive permit? Your answer is no. From what I can see here, you may want to re-examine the answer to that question. You don't have to do it now. I'm just pointing out to you that in terms of the application, you might want to go through this again, because I think there are a variety of things that are now slightly out of sync with the original application. Okay, just go through them one by one, and I think you'll see that it's eight of tenable.
Right, and you need to conform it, as Attorney Reed pointed out, to the plan.
Yes. We are definitely happy to. I believe the previous owner, Hatch's current owner. So previous owner would be the party 6 years ago that owned it. Because Hetch's current owner, we have site control. So that is why that answer, we weren't trying.
I think that's the previous owner they're referring to in this application. Okay,
I'll confirm.
Take a look. Just take a look at it.
Just point
out, just so it's not problematic later on. And just, take a quick look at it, because I don't think, once you put this in, I think it...
We want to get it right. We're happy to look at it.
You've got some adjustments to make in that application, okay? That's all. Okay, that's all I got on site control.
Anything else on site control? Okay, now, Attorney Brody's not here. I know he took extensive notes, because we had a number of comments and questions from the public. I don't know if you're prepared to address those.
I do have a list here, and I would be happy to. The top of the list was site control. The second question I have, and this is not in a particular order, I guess, is a homeowners association, which we have provided drafts. And again, those are drafts. The homeowners association would be created right before we sell the homes. Oh, I thought that was a question. There were questions about landscaping and what we would like to do, and maybe it's at a later point, is to find out from the board what areas you have concerns with, because again, because this is complex, but we'd also say good and beneficial. There are some complexities about landscaping and who's doing what, and we want to make sure that what we promise is comprehensive and will achieve what the board is looking for habitat and our landscaping. We like to maintain flexibility for our home lots, because those homes are built by the home buyers with their own sweat equity. When it comes to gardening, we provide hydro seed and some foundation plantings, and those may change between now. If we say rhododendrons, it might turn out that that home buyer's favorite bush is forsythia. So it's a little bit different, again, than maybe the for-profit developer who's saying, I'm going to do three affordable and nine market, and this is my landscaping plan. But what we do think is important, and we want to work closely with the board and the community, is what areas of the site do people see, for instance, fencing or screening or an entryway. So those are the types of landscaping elements we would very much like to talk to you about. The individual home lots, we would like to keep some flexibility.
Okay, and I'd like to see that in a landscape plan that the board would say yes on or no on. It's some. Okay.
But what does help us is if we hear what the community concerns are.
Okay. Okay.
You know, is it the entryway? Is it, because again, we like to keep the flexibility for what we think of as yards. Let's just, like, I have the flexibility in my yard. We are going to be providing a slightly revised site plan. We wanted to wait and hear comments, and then we're going to incorporate them all. We are looking at just a few rotations of the home buildings based on some input we've had as the time has gone by from an architect. We had a question here about heat pumps, which I'm happy to answer. Are heat pumps there? And I know, because when I started at Habitat, I had this idea that, oh, those don't work in cold weather climates. Technology has increased phenomenally. They are now good, and I confirmed with our installer, to 5 below 0. And they are ducted, not ductless, and they are heat and hot water and air conditioning. And they are the, we install the Mitsubishi, I have the manufacturer's number, but I don't think you folks care about XL27, but they do qualify on the Massachusetts Clean Energy Center site for the highest rebates.
They are wall units?
No. The wall units are the ductless. This is a unit in the basement and ducted. Do you know about heat? I love them. I mean, I shouldn't say. They're just incredibly efficient. Whenever we meet with energy efficiency people, sustainability people, they are very excited at what we are doing. Our homes score close to zero on HERS scale if we have the solar panels on them, which means that they produce as much energy as they use. We do a lot of insulation and pay a lot of attention to creating a good envelope. Okay, next on my list is septic systems. And what I would say is there was a lot of discussion about septic systems at our last meeting and about environmental concerns. And, you know, we have our expert here. We're happy to entertain more questions and try to answer them. What we're saying is that what we're doing is permittable. It all is fine under the regulations. You have at your disposal your own expertise. You have, you know, your Board of Health and your conservation agent. So I would ask that if you have questions that, you know, we're answering and our expert will answer, but if you have more, that they are your resource.
On that point, we would not generally turn to our own departments for that kind of thing. That would be more the subject matter of a peer review.
I mean, if that is, you know, what this board needs.
We haven't discussed that yet, but we may get to that. Okay. But I don't think we're going to turn to our own Board of Health and our own building department and so forth to be, you know, experts on design of a project. We wouldn't typically do that.
I believe they have commented on it. I mean, one, yeah.
We've gotten comments, sure.
We're not going to have them, you know, provide expert testimony about, you know.
Different towns work differently. Many times with smaller projects, a board will rely on their departments for expertise. However, works for Harwich.
Good. Thank you. That's good.
The plume, there were some questions about that. And again, you know, we're happy to try to answer. We did the environmental review. We have the report. Anyone has any more questions? Just reading through, I had comments, but not specific questions. You know, the plume is out there. Again, your health department knows a lot about that and has a lot of information. We did our own report. Our environmental expert has said our homes are fine, the area is fine. There was a comment that the lots are too small. And on that one, this is the nature of 40B. This is the nature of trying to create affordable housing. Housing is unaffordable, and part of the barrier to affordability is the cost of land. Now, if we could buy one lot and put one house in it, other people could do that too, and it wouldn't be an affordable crisis. But there is, and Harwich needs housing, and the way to create affordable housing is to enhance the density. That is the purpose of 40B. We are trying to do it respectfully. You know, we feel that our lot sizes, small is a tough word. There are 5,000 square foot lots in communities I work in. These are larger than that. These are smaller than the neighbors to the east and the west, but the same size as those to the south. You know, we feel that this will make an attractive neighborhood, and that is important to us. Again, we are a mission-driven nonprofit. We create homes. We're not just about units. Sometimes, because I'm on the permitting end, I slip into talk of units and deed riders. But it's about, you know, the folks who build these homes and live in them. And we don't look to create a neighborhood that's not something someone wants to be home. This is very similar in density to Oak Street, and we feel that that was a very successful neighborhood. This is the density that we need on the site to make it feasible financially. And if we thought it was too small in our expertise of having built and sold 103 homes on the Cape, we wouldn't have started this project. You know, we care about our buyers, and we care about what we do. That also goes to the question of why not just four homes? Four homes will not be financially feasible. At the beginning, there was some talk. There was talk of 4 to 8 homes. There was talk of 12 homes. In the beginning of project exploration, there is discussion. You know, as you start working with the engineers, with the designers, you firm up the number that works, and 6 is the number that works. Someone had asked about PERC tests. Again, this is a permitting level. When we know, you know, what and when and approvals, then we go to the next level of construction drawings. Those do get submitted back to the zoning board, you know, to the building department. We had been asked about guest parking, and on the next iteration of site plans, we'll show deeper driveway so that, you know, you could have the 2 cars in, and then when your visitors come, they park behind you. Let's see, we had been asked about rehabilitation and why aren't we just doing those front homes. I think that would take some of the complexity out of this. It would make it easier to settle our heads around. But that's not the Habitat for Humanity of Cape Cod model. You know, some people ask me, well, you know, Habitat in this town does it. We've done a few rehab projects, mostly helping folks. Our core model is new construction. It's getting the volunteers on site. It's working with our home buyers, and that's what we do. If we were asked to do rehab, we'd say, no, thank you, not at this moment. We have a lot of new construction going on. And Vicki Goldsmith, if she wants, can, you know, talk more to our model. But I just think it's, you know, it's like asking, why don't we build a high rise? You know, that's not our model. It's not what we do. You know, we do what we're good at. And then there were questions about lots 7 and 8. And permit request is for the 6 units. So 4 on 97 and 2 on 93. There was a lot of questions about the Chase home, and some of this is more to Hetch to ask. That's why everyone is here. But Hetch will require the buyer to record a historic preservation restriction. And since our last meeting, we've been in discussions. A full exterior, not just the facade, will be required. So I think that hopefully answers a lot of questions there.
I'm sorry, would you repeat that?
The historic preservation restriction on the Chase home that Hetch will be requiring from their buyer will be for the full exterior, not just the facade.
So is this property goes from Hetch to Habitat for Humanity to Hetch to the anticipated new buyer that will remain?
That is a promise that Hetch made to the town, and this is also part of why I'm not picking on shell game, but I think the complexity, and this is why we wanted, you know, real transparency. Habitat did not make that promise to the town. Hetch did. So it makes the most sense for Hatch to be the one who then either keeps that home as a rental and records that historic preservation restriction or sells it. That was their promise to the town of Harwich, and that helps.
So the repair and replace for the external would remain as it is, essentially. The internals, they could do what they wanted to, but the repair and replace is only allowed for the external, for the Hatch. They can't modify it in such a way, they can't modify the external portion of the house at all.
That is my understanding. I'm an affordable housing expert. I'm not a historic preservation expert. In a way, we are bending over backwards to try to accommodate community wishes, and this was part of it.
I think that's very important for the town, for the historic, so that's why I just mentioned it. Okay, thank you.
So can I just clarify a point then? I understand you're prepared to record a covenant and a preservation agreement. So it would be the owner of the property, whoever it turns out to ultimately be, his obligation to restore that property.
I do not think it's restoration, which is a different level
I just want to make sure I understand this restriction and what, who is required to do what and when. Maybe Andrew can.
Yeah.
The historic preservation restriction, think of it like a conservation restriction. It is a document that is prepared. It is reviewed and signed off on by the town. And then it has to be reviewed and signed off by the state level of at the Mass Historical Commission. It is a lengthy document. I've reviewed the model that they recommend. And it is a document that does not require restoration, as you said, but it requires preservation. So, and there are rules, lots of rules, as to what you have to do, certain materials you have to use, certain permissions you have to get, if you're going to be seeking to make any changes, you know, change out the windows, you know, that are rotting or whatever it might be. There's a whole series of protocols, and you are correct that we would anticipate a condition that discusses this. The ultimate owner, whether it's Hatch, third party, whomever owns the 97 lot 7, will be required to enter into that historic preservation restriction, take it all the way through the town, up to the state, get it signed off and then recorded. And then that would govern the property. It would run with the chain of title.
I think the expectation, I think that what people are assuming here, that this is some kind of an agreement where this building will be restored and look wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And most of these agreements I've read, frankly, what they do is prevent demolition by neglect. That's all. They don't really bring a level of, let's put it this way, a gold standard of renovation to some of these buildings. I just think that the public ought to, and the board ought to understand that, so that we're not let down later on, what's really being proposed here. Most of the public is never going to read, you know, this agreement or this restriction, and so it would be, I think, good for the public to hear precisely what will happen, who will do it, and when. Above and beyond the legal documentation. So I'm just passing this along as part of the hearing process. I think that would be helpful to the public and certainly helpful to us in evaluating, you know, to what extent there's a public benefit that comes to the community out of this. And, you know, clearly we're not looking, the only public benefit is housing. There are other public benefits that come from these things, and that would certainly be helpful. People seem to think these historic preservation agreements are going to, all of a sudden, this building is going to get repainted and revived and look like $1 million. That's not what they do.
And I'm not going to stand here and tell you that it's going to be turned into the Taj Mahal and look beautiful,
right,
and gorgeous. The person, whoever's going to buy it,
right,
is going to have an obligation to maintain it and to preserve it and to preserve what is there, which is the historic structure. I can't speak to the future other than to say that the chain of title will have this restriction on it, which is not there today.
The unfortunate part about it, the reality is of enforcing these, you know, demolition by neglect things takes years and years and years. They're almost like tax takings. You practically have to wait till the building's falling down before anybody actually takes any action under these things. And that's why I think it would be helpful to know, is there in fact a proposal for work to be done? If there's not, fine. Just tell us. That's all. Thank you.
Yes, proceed, please.
I think I was at the end of my list, I believe. I believe that the board will have questions. And, oh, one other piece, I'm sorry, no, I wasn't at the end of my list because I saved this, the end of our document, is waivers. And I think a waiver that we had asked for has also added some complexity. It was one of the waivers where we were saying that these would be considered as if they were pre-existing non-conforming, and we're happy to delete that waiver. I'll put that in writing with our other updated.
I was going to ask you about that. I'm not sure we have the legal capacity to even do that. And I was going to ask you to submit, you know, some legal authority for us to confer that kind of a status on property. I'm not sure any zoning board can give you that.
It actually came from another zoning board in reaction to some 40Bs that they have had in their town, and the idea that here's a single family home, you know, on an albeit smaller lot, but in a residential area, and this person wants to, say, build a shed. That's not a good example because we're providing sheds, but just that it would make that a standard process, just like if I wanted to go build a shed on my land, as long as it conformed to setbacks, they could go get their shed permit instead of having to come in for an amendment to a comprehensive permit.
So you are withdrawing.
We're deleting it. I'm sorry, I shouldn't.
Withdrawing the request for that waiver.
Yes.
So let us know that in writing, too. We could do this letter, this follow-up.
Now, is that the waiver under general?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that whole thing will now come out.
Right.
Okay.
We are working to try to make this. It is complex, and we do want to make it as understandable and a way that works for Harwich.
Did you also delete waiver 7?
The historic?
Waiver 7, chapter 131.
It was felt that we didn't need that, correct?
Historic preservation?
Yep.
I thought you kind of did, but I'm not sure.
W7's coming out?
We are happy to, if this board is saying we don't need it, and Andrew, if he feels that for the existing.
I mean, I don't have a problem as long as we say, but it doesn't affect the applicant's obligation to record the preservation restriction.
It means they don't have to live with the preservation if they waive it.
No, not if we modify it. So it doesn't. We cut out.
What legal authority would we have to waive chapter 131?
We don't. That's the issue.
We're happy to delete it. And
okay. Let's take it out then. Okay.
I don't think so, right?
I have to say, I don't remember the exact language, but it's obviously regarding historic preservation.
Yeah.
Based on the fact that there'll be a restriction, if it's not needed, it's not needed.
It's not needed.
It's not needed.
Right. Okay. It's not really a waiver.
No.
Okay. Just so we don't have it on our list.
As long as we're on waivers, I'm going to address a few other comments I have. Since we seem to be on that subject. On W2, Article 6, Area Height and Bulk Regulations.
Yes.
Instead of waive this article in its entirety, I'd like to strike that. And I'd like to say the following requirements are waived, but only to the extent required to conduct the affordable units in accordance with the plans and drawings submitted with the application and all final approved plans.
So. Affordable and market.
Yeah.
This was the affordable units, the market.
We would need it just as, back to our hypothetical 12 homes, the 9 market rate homes are still on their smaller lots.
Well, when we get to conditions, let's hold that in abeyance.
One other technical point on exactly that. This goes back to my original question about re-examine your application. Re-examine your waivers, because there's changes here, too. I think you want changes.
We typically, there's an ebb and flow, and... Mm-hmm. We're happy to.
If you want to update the waiver list, because based on the way you've got this structured now, you need to.
Let's talk about that. We'll come back to that when we go through the conditions, because I'm not prepared to recommend to the board that we grant the market rates, you know, carte blanche from these requirements.
Can't.
Yeah. The next paragraph down from that little block there with the requirements. It says, okay, waivers requested from this article include but are not limited to the above dimensional requirements, as well as a request for a waiver from section 325.18a, waive minimum width of lots and shape number requirements, section 325.18c, waive requirements for corner lot, section 325.18G. And at that point, I would like to just insert, subject to note one, waive setback requirements for accessory structures. I think you should have that reference down to your note there.
Oh.
Otherwise, note one is sort of just floating there.
Thank you.
Note two, I don't see why we need to have plus or minus 5%. Once we have our final plans, we have our final plans.
I sometimes ask for the world. Oh, we're happy to delete that. That has,
I'd like to delete that, yes.
That has thanks. Come in handy just for field conditions when things are a little off.
Okay.
So happy to delete it.
Okay, but I think if it's, I think you should come back to us. You've done that on, I forget which project, where something changed and you came back in just to run it by us from the final plans.
We're happy
just so
to
we have
that.
A chance to look at it. Okay, this also goes to one of the points raised by Attorney Reed under W11, reducing the right-of-way from 50 feet to 40 feet. I have no problem with respect to the, you know, the units that are proposed. I do have a very big concern, though, about what happens with the neighbor at 87 when they're given access.
Thank you. Let me update the board on that. At this point, the neighbor isn't seemingly interested in using any of our cul-de-sac right of way. That idea, it's been a
being
long
a good
day.
Neighbor.
Yes.
No, we still like to be a good neighbor. I don't believe, I don't want to speak for her, but the panhandle wasn't something that she had, you know, called me and said, oh, I want a panhandle.
So
we had made that offer.
Are we taking that out then? Because if so, I'd like that confirmed in the letter.
Okay.
Because I think the application covers that.
Yeah.
And there was, I think the public had concern, Attorney Reed has concern. I have concern, probably the other board members do too. Now, I notice your neighbor's got heavy equipment back there. Do you know what she's up to?
I believe her engineer might know.
We did a septic system upgrade for her a while back, so they're probably putting that in.
Just for the existing house?
Yeah.
You know?
Is okay. It in a flood zone?
Okay, so are we going to delete that then?
Yes, we will delete that.
Okay. With respect to that house, I'm okay leaving the 50 to 40 for your own, you know, proposal.
Just a question regarding the cul-de-sac. Is the width of the road, I understand the way it's written, it's sufficient to get a trailer truck through with certain considerations, as well as snow plows with other considerations. But let me ask you a question. If you had somebody parked on the side of the road and it happened to be a UPS truck, is it possible for another car to get by? Or are we really saying that the road cannot be used for parking?
Dan from Down Cape Engineering. A UPS truck on the shoulder, you know, it's a truck to be on the road. It can only be 8 feet wide. You know, mirrors might be a couple inches more. And we've got over 20 feet of pavement at the narrowest. So you could easily get by a UPS truck, even with a fire truck. You know, in terms of, you know, parking on the road, we hear you. It's a short dead-end road, and there's a few houses on it. So we're going to make the driveways a little bit longer just to encourage people to get off the road and not
good
park.
Idea.
Yeah, so
good
they can
idea.
Double
so
park.
If a house happened to have two cars, you'd have two cars.
Well, no. Even now we've got two, but just about room for four on all of them.
Good.
By the time we get done, yeah.
Good. Okay, thank you.
Okay, my last comment on the waivers under general. I'd like to strike that very last provision where you want waivers from everything else you might need at some point in the future. No, you come back to us if you have a specific request.
We have never had a zoning board accept
nice
that one.
Yeah, that's definitely a no-no. Does anyone else on the board have any comments on the waivers?
I'm good.
Very nice. I used to try that too when I was a lawyer, but now that I'm on the zoning board, I don't try that kind of stuff anymore. One question that I would like to hear some comment on, Attorney Reed raised that basically lots 7 and 8 now are illegal uses, multifamily uses that were never permitted. I'd like to hear a comment on that. Maybe Attorney Singer could comment on that for us, please.
I am.
I did get a copy of David Reed's letter and did review it, and I spoke with Hetch about it. Excuse me. I don't think David's in the room.
He's not here.
But I will say publicly, I faced David before at several meetings, so I'll say this publicly, and those in the room can repeat this to him. I don't think I've ever agreed with him publicly at a meeting, but I'm going to agree with him on one point tonight. He may be correct that how the organic development of these number of units on the, in the buildings created doesn't have permits. And we can't tell you that's right, we can't tell you it's wrong, but he's probably right. Hetch bought the property more than a decade ago. When they bought the property, there were three units in the house, none in the garage, in the barn, although there was, you can tell that it used to be used for that, and two in the duplex. They haven't changed the use since they bought it. So the best I can tell you is that when they bought the property, it was exactly the same as what the property is today. Now, however, although David's comment about the past permitting of the property might be right, what's before you on this project is exactly how you deal with that. And it's under the comprehensive permit that that will be reviewed, approved, and conditioned. So if that, hopefully that answers the question.
Yeah, no, I understood that. I just wanted the public to hear that from you. I would ask, we have Peck here, you might want to take a look at your inventory of properties to see if any of them are in a similar situation where you really ought to come in and get special permits, if so, because this is not a good situation for you folks. It's not great for us either, but I think you should take a look at it, and if
about
you need
the planning department, why haven't they picked it up?
Well, because they don't look at that kind of stuff, I don't think. It would be up to our building inspector, but they don't, he doesn't
work. If I could just respond quickly to that, Vice President of Hetch Board just mentioned to me, most of what they own and have done has been things they've built. So they don't have a lot of properties like this.
Okay.
Very good point. They can follow up, but it does not impact most of what they own or would not.
Okay, thank you.
So what essentially you're saying is because we grant you a permit under this comprehensive plan, we have granted you that either waiver or whatever it is, special permit, to create those units in those houses.
No, they haven't transferred that under the permit.
They get it here.
Yes, if we approve the permit.
If we approve the permit, you get it here. If we do not approve the permit, what happens?
They'd have to come in for a special permit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm
very serious. If we don't approve it here, because we don't have. I guess what you're doing is you're asking us. You're asking this board to grant you either the variance or the special permit to create those units in those houses, which never, at least as far as we can tell, which were never permitted in the first place. So by us granting this permit today, if you will, we're giving you those waivers or that variance or that special permit on those homes. We're granting it. There's no recourse. That's it. They're given. Am I correct?
Well, Habitat's not asking for a special permit or a variance. What they are asking for is under the comprehensive permit, at the end of the day, you're right. The comprehensive permit will authorize 12 units on all of this land that's on that plan.
And they will grant the conditions that those homes on that street have three units and two units in them, which they shouldn't, maybe they shouldn't have had. They are illegal, maybe, but we're granting them by granting this particular application in the next week or two, whenever it happens, we're granting that. There's no recourse. I mean, it's a given. You can't go back. Let me ask you, if somebody was to come into us 6 weeks from now after we did this and said, you cannot have granted
this permit because those homes are, have units in them that don't belong, and the town has never granted either variances or special permits. And we say, wait a minute, we already granted them by giving the special, by giving this comprehensive permit. Because that's the way I take, that's the way I take what we're doing.
Okay, wait a minute, Dean.
I might suggest that maybe you, by the next hearing or something, you might want to supply us with some authority. You might want to supply us with some authority on this issue. And let me see how, if I can frame this. In the building that has three units, you have what's called a multifamily use.
Right.
There's only two units. It's not multifamily. The multifamily use is a prohibited use in this zone. There is nothing in the application that requests any relief under the use provisions of the bylaw, which a comprehensive permit would have to request. That's the whole idea of the comprehensive permit. You're going to come in here and ask us to waive certain provisions
right.
of the bylaw. Normally, these are dimensional and some use provisions. This is a use issue. The application doesn't request that I can recall. I guess the question is there authority for us to essentially, by way of a comprehensive permit, authorize an illegal use in that zone? I don't know. I don't know the answer to that, but I
or violating the zone.
But by definition, everything you do under a 40B is authorizing use that's not allowed, because you are not allowed under current zoning to have 8, 10, 6, 5 houses on this piece of property.
Well, I guess we need some authority on, you know, to the extent we have an illegal use.
Mm-hmm. Existing,
you know, can we then legitimize that through a special permit? You're saying we can't.
Yes, I believe it's part of what the 40B authorizes.
Yeah, well, I think we need some authority on that. I'm not necessarily, I don't think.
What they're saying is the 40B grants them the authorities they need.
No, we understand that.
Yeah, we understand.
John said, let's see some cases on it.
Yeah.
If there are any.
It, unless, of course, you wanted to accept a condition that that building only had two units in it.
Speaking of conditions, unless the board has anything else, I'd like to go over the conditions.
Nothing else.
I'd like the public to hear these. I don't have enough for the public, so we're going to go through them one by one. And then I'll give the public a chance to speak, because hopefully some of these conditions, if the board ultimately elects to grant the permit, which hasn't been determined at all at this point, will alleviate some of the concerns that have been raised.
And I can post these on
the website. Yes, you can put them on the website. And we did get some additional correspondence, which will be posted on the website. Okay, I've got two for your table, and I think Attorney Singer, you probably should have a
Dave,
copy.
May I have one?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I passed one down. Oh, here it is. Yes, I've got one more.
I think do believe that this is as much of a hazard.
I think that's critical.
Let's go through these. Okay, a lot of these early ones I took from the Oak Street Habitat, so they should not be unfamiliar to you. And I'm just going to read them. Sorry for the tedious effort, but since we don't have copies, that I'd like you folks out there to hear it. And some of these are standard, but I think these are things the board's going to want to see in any permit that would be granted. Number one, development of the site shall be in substantial conformance with the preliminary plans entitled, and then they would state the name of the plans consisting of how many sheets there are. Two, the dwelling unit shall be constructed in substantial conformance with the elevation and floor plans entitled, and they would state the name of the plans consisting of how many sheets. So that means they have to construct the units in substantial accordance with the plans that are here preliminary and will ultimately become final, and that's what the building permit would be issued on. Three, the applicant shall prepare detailed development and construction plans consistent with this decision. All applicable town standards and recommendations except those waived by this decision
all engineering standards and all applicable building and fire codes. Prior to issuance of building permits or any construction, all plans shall be reviewed and approved for consistency with this decision by appropriate town agencies and departments. Four, once the 6 affordable housing certificates of occupancy have been issued, there shall be no dumpsters or other similar outdoor receptacles for collective storage of trash, rubbish, or garbage. All outdoor receptacles of trash, rubbish, or garbage shall be on individual lots for the sole use of that individual lot owner. Five, placement of propane tanks, if any, shall adhere to all applicable town and state regulations, including 527 CMR 6. Six, the applicant shall prepare a subdivision plan suitable for endorsement by the board and recorded at the Registry of Deeds. The board shall endorse such plan if the board finds it is consistent and within acceptable limits with the preliminary plan presented for the division of the land and that all applicable conditions have been met. The plan shall reference this decision. Again, this contemplates a positive decision. We're just, at this point, putting it out for the applicant for discussion. Seven, a stormwater runoff pollution prevention plan shall be approved by the town engineering department. All plans and specifications shall be per the, and then they would state the name of the plans consisting of however many sheets, and all work shall be reviewed and shall be in compliance with the requirements of the town engineering department prior to the issuance of a building permit for any of the affordable house lots. Eight, inspections necessary to ensure completion of the road work to applicable standards shall be set by the town engineering department. Nine, utilities shall be installed in accordance with the requirements of the utility companies and state and town requirements. 10, prior to issuance of a certificate of occupancy for any of the affordable units, the applicant shall landscape the property using drought-tolerant plants and a minimum of 5 inches of loam on any disturbed areas of the site, which shall then be seeded with grass of a type suitable for the location it is being applied to. All landscaping shall be done in accordance with a landscape plan approved by the board. 11, all 6 affordable units shall be affordable units under the Department of Housing and Community Development Local Initiative Program. Upon initial sale to eligible and qualified households, applicants shall record a Department of Housing and Community Development Local Initiative Program affordable housing deed rider, which shall include a provision that the units shall be affordable in perpetuity. All units shall be for sale as single-family units. Ownership and resale shall be as outlined in the Department of Housing and Community Development Local Initiative Program affordable housing deed rider. 12, to the extent allowable by law, 70% of the affordable units shall be local preference units. Upon approval by the Department of Housing and Community Development, current residents of the town of Harwich, municipal employees of the town of Harwich, employees of businesses in the town of Harwich, and households with children attending household schools will be given a preference in the initial lottery.
Mr. Chair, I have a question about this. Would you like me to hold it?
No, go right ahead.
70% of 6 is 4.2. I wonder, could we specify a certain number of units?
Well, this is the legal standard, so.
Unfortunately, for those who like the local preference, the Department of Housing and Community Development will require us to round down.
So 4, okay, in effect. And Harwich schools, do we need to reference now Monomoy schools? And since we're in an area of school choice, we have kids who live in Harwich going to Chatham Elementary School. We have kids going to the Lighthouse Charter School.
I don't think we can do that.
If the children are living here and going to school outside of Harwich, mm-hmm. Their families will be deemed local families because they're living
so
here.
It's moving.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
You want to read some of these?
You want to read? You want a break?
Yeah, I do.
All right,
How about a family in Dennis who lives in Dennis and their child's attending the Harwich Elementary School under school choice?
That family would get local preference?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, they would, yeah. This is pretty much statutory, this language.
Thank you.
I can speak a little bit about our families in general, if you'd like, and their local connections.
Okay, continuing on with the proposed condition number 13. The project shall comply with all local initiative program requirements and any conditions the Department of Housing and Community Development in its role as subsidizing agency may require as part of final approval under 760 CMR 56.04. 14, a regulatory agreement pursuant to the local initiative program and consistent with the terms of the comprehensive permit in form and content approved by the Town of Harwich shall be executed by the subsidizing agency, the Town of Harwich, and the applicant. Said agreement shall be recorded at the Barnstable County Registry of Deeds prior to the issuance of any building permits. 15, the applicant shall prepare an affirmative fair housing market plan prepared in accordance with Section 3 of 40B guidelines and approved by the Department of Housing and Community Development prior to the commencement of marketing of the units. A copy of this plan will be provided to the board prior to the issuance of building permits. 16, this comprehensive permit is issued to the applicant, Habitat for Humanity of Cape Cod, Inc. It shall not be transferable without the prior written approval of the board. 17, all required state permits and approvals, including but not limited to Title V, wastewater, disposal permit shall be submitted to the board's file prior to issuance of a building permit. 18. Prior to the issuance of a building permit, the applicant shall obtain all required approvals from the Town Conservation Commission, and copies of any issued permit shall be submitted to the board's file prior to the issuance of a building permit. 19. In order to prepare any connection to a sewer system, a sewer line will exit each affordable unit on the street side of the unit. 20, each affordable and market rate unit will be serviced by Town of Harwich Water. 21, prior to the issuance of any permits for this project, the comprehensive permit shall be recorded at the Barnstable Registry of Deeds. A copy of the recorded document shall be submitted to the board's file. 22, the configuration of the affordable unit shall be as follows. 2 three-bedroom capes, each 1,284 square feet with 2 bathrooms and 2 parking spaces. 2 three-bedroom ranches, each of 1,200 square feet with 1.5 bathrooms and 2 parking spaces. And 2 two-bedroom ranches, each 972 square feet with 1 bathroom and 2 parking spaces. 23, prior to the issuance of the first occupancy permit, each homeowner of an affordable market rate home covered by the comprehensive permit shall be required to enter in a homeowners association agreement. I'm sorry, I missed one word. Any homeowner of any affordable or market rate covered by the comprehensive permit shall be required to enter into a homeowners association agreement. The homeowners association agreement shall prohibit garbage disposals, prohibit irrigation and drinking water wells, require the owners to reasonably maintain their properties and grounds, require that the owners to reasonably cooperate with the town and the state on the location of any future sidewalks along Route 28, require the owners to promptly remove any snow windrows along the project site frontage on Route 28 within the site triangle areas of the project where such accumulations would exceed 2.5 feet in height, prohibit the owners from installing or planting anything within 10 feet of the edge of the paved roadway.
Let me just make a comment. I really think it's important that the market rate lots be subject to the homeowners association, because when you look at your traffic study, these lines of sight and getting the snow off really are applicable to everything along Route 28. And I also think we need that property to be maintained reasonably, just like the affordable housing units. And since you've got site control, there's no problem in putting all of the units under the homeowners association, at least in my opinion. I don't know what the other board members think.
Yeah, we can. We'll follow up. We'll discuss.
But you understand my concern. I think, you know, we've got site control now. If we have site control,
it should be easy.
It should be easy to do this now.
One day.
Go ahead, John.
Number 24. A, any building to be constructed on the market rate lots, and B, any renovation of an existing building on a market rate lot will be on the same footprint as currently existing structure and will not exceed the current configuration of the structure. The configuration of each of the three existing structures is as follows. One building of 1,512 square feet with a maximum of 2 units with a total of 5 bedrooms and 3 baths. One building of 2,379 square feet with a maximum of 3 units with a total of 6 bedrooms
and 3.5 baths, and one building of 732 square feet with a maximum of one unit with a total of two bedrooms and one bath.
Yeah, let me comment on that. Again, the applicant is coming before us and asking us to, for waivers and, you know, to approve uses that at the moment aren't allowed in this zone. And I think if the board sees fit to do that without any plans for development on these market rate units, other than a restriction on the exterior of the Chase House, we need to put some limits on what's going to happen on those lots in the future. And I don't know of any other way, sitting here without plans and specs, to do it than to require you to, if you're going to rebuild, it's going to be on the footprint, it's going to be the square footage, the number of bedrooms, and if the subsequent owner wants to do something different, they're going to have to come in and, I guess, ask us for an amendment to the permit.
There's another reason. The other reason is this particular area is subject to commercial.
Well,
and therefore they could get commercial, well, so they have to retain these as private homes.
Let's keep going. That's got that covered too.
Yeah, he's dealt with that later.
Yeah. Go ahead, John.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
And C, the architectural style and building materials of any such new construction or renovation will be generally consistent with those of the six affordable units. Number 25, the applicant will reasonably work with Cape Cod Commission to develop a preservation restriction for the facade of the...
No, that's got to be changed. It's for the exterior, right? Okay, right. So that will now be for the exterior.
And it wouldn't be the Cape Cod Commission, it would be the Mass Historical Commission.
Yes.
Okay.
And the Board of Selectmen.
Yes, you have to file with them, but the Cape Cod Commission and the correspondents had offered to work with the applicant on developing the restriction. But if you want the Mass Historical, I've got no problem. It's got to be filed with Mass Historical ultimately, so let's say Mass Historical Commission.
Okay, so not facade, the entire building, I guess, of the Judah Chase House and barn.
The exterior, I believe, would be.
What would it be?
Exterior.
Exterior, oh yeah.
The exterior.
The exterior, yeah.
Exterior.
Yeah, not the interior, yeah, right.
Yes.
Such a preservation restriction shall be recorded at the Barnstable Registry of Deeds and any other appropriate governmental registry required to give it full effect prior to the issuance of any certificate of occupancy for the affordable rate unit, for any affordable rate unit, and in any event prior to the transfer of title to either of the market rate lots.
And let me just comment on that point. I don't want to leave it to a subsequent third party. I think this ought to be recorded before the applicant sells the lot back to HEC. Now, you might have to amend your purchase and sale agreement, or, you know, I don't really care how you work out the mechanics, but I really think that needs to be on the land record. You're the applicant, you're dealing with us, you have site control. We don't want to worry about, it would actually be, I don't know, a third or fourth party, how many down the line. We want it on the registry, so every subsequent owner is going to take subject to it.
We understand what you're asking. I believe that we're going to need to go and look at these and come back. There's
some details that
we just can't say yes or no, and I see some timing
issues. I'm just trying
to
give you my rationale.
I understand. Thank you.
I don't expect you to accept all of them. Maybe, actually, there were 31. I misstated because I had to redo the numbers. I expect you to take 30 of them, but maybe one you could knock out. But okay, go ahead.
We'll try to take as many as we can.
Must have stayed up late at night doing these. 26. Vehicles entering the project site shall be placed under stop sign control with a marked stop line provided. 27. All signs and paper.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to see a marked crosswalk there as well.
At the entrance?
At the entrance onto Route 28.
Is that section of that road state highway?
It is.
Yes.
I believe that has to get approved by the state to put a...
That's a state highway, yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, we can ask for it, but I don't think it's anything you can just do.
Exactly.
I'm not asking for a crosswalk to cross 28. I'm asking for a crosswalk to cross from one side of
the driveway or their road going in.
Their road.
Well, they can certainly do
that.
Yeah. Is there a sidewalk on that side?
No.
Okay. Is there a sidewalk there?
No, there's no sidewalk.
No sidewalk. I wouldn't want to create an attractive nuisance where you invite somebody to walk across and then just dump them onto a green area.
I'm not sure.
If there's ever a sidewalk
idea.
Installed, they would
well, you
do
know,
that.
I guess we,
yeah.
you know, why don't we defer that to the police chief?
Yeah, being a state highway.
Let him make the call on that one. I don't think we should do that.
These couple here come right out of their own traffic report. These were recommendations from their traffic person, which I thought was pretty good recommendations. So I think we should put them in the conditions.
Also, just a quick note that was donated, and we very much appreciate his work.
Okay, well, I do too, so.
Okay, next one, all 27. All signs and pavement markings to be installed within the project site shall conform to the applicable standards on the manual on uniform traffic control devices. 28, signs and landscape features to be installed along project site roadways internal to the project and within the site triangle of the project site roadway intersection with Route 28 shall be designed and maintained so as to not to restrict lines of sight. 29, prior to the issuance of a building permit, the applicant shall obtain a written agreement from the owner of 87 Main Street to allow paving in front of the affordable housing lots, regrading of the slope on the northwestern property line of said lots and trimming of the lower branches of the pine trees along Route 28 to improve line of sight in the existing project.
No, exiting the project.
Exiting the project, yeah. 30, if the school bus pickup and delivery point for children within the project will be along Route 28, the applicant will install a bus shelter prior to the commencement of the school year following the issuance of the first certificate of occupancy for any affordable unit. And 31, this comprehensive permit is granted for the use of lots 7 and 8, the market rate lots, for residential purposes only.
In perpetuity, you're right.
In perpetuity.
Well, I had that, but I took it out.
Why?
Because they can always come back and request a change.
Yeah, they could. They could come back in for a variance or change of use. Yeah, they can.
So
yeah.
Those are the conditions then.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Burke.
Those are good. Thank you.
I have one issue I think we should bring up tonight.
Okay, wait a minute. Let me just, before we get off of conditions.
If you want to do it after the public, it's fine. I don't care.
No, we'll do it after this, but does anyone on the board have any additional conditions they would like to propose to the applicant?
I've said my piece. I'll be quiet.
I'd like to request a clarification rather than a condition between the lot size specified in the permit application and the lot sizes specified in the site plan.
I believe that was an error, transponding of 7 and 8, between 8 and 7.
And 6 as well.
We will go through and correct all the items.
And which do you think is correct? The site plan or the...
Oh, the site plan is definitely correct. An engineer did the site plan.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Burke.
One other issue I just want to bring up, because I think we should do this early in the process here, and that is the issue where there was the Bennett Environmental report that was submitted to us, speaking to members of the board here. And it deals with the plume issue, which seems to be of significant public concern. This may be a non-issue at all, but I don't know. I'm not qualified to understand the entire methodology. I mean, I understand the conclusion of the consultant, and as we know, consultants work for applicants and want
to... You mean the oil spill?
No, this is about the
plume.
Plume. And I would think that we would be serving the public's best interest and ours if we had this matter peer-reviewed, rather than us trying to pass judgment on an environmental report for which none of us are really qualified to evaluate. And that would be the custom. The typical subject matters that get peer-reviewed would be environmental issues and traffic issues. I don't have a sense that there's any traffic issue, frankly, involved in this project at all. They did do a minor traffic study, but I don't really see...
Not with the owner's access knocked out. No,
right. I really... but the environmental issue...
Adjoining owner.
Because there's been so much question about this, it would be in the public's best interest, and certainly ours, that we have some other consultant on our behalf peer review this report to assure... By the way, peer review, as you know, just is a review of the methodology used by the consultant to assure us that the study was done properly. It's not designed to come to some other conclusion or write a new report or anything like that. Peer review is just that, to review the methodology. So I'm just suggesting to the board, because it takes time to get peer review.
Right.
We should be talking about this now, because typically what happens is the board will then turn to staff, and they will get quotes from people who are under contract with the town currently, so that under the acquisition statute, we may not have to go out to bid. There may be people already pre-bid to the town who provide services like this, may not. We may have to go to bid for services like this. But I don't know how I just bring it up to the board, how they, do you feel comfortable making a judgment on this report yourself, or do you feel that you need a consultant to assure you that this report was done correctly? I'm not an environmental consultant. I have no idea. I would prefer to peer review myself.
And my recollection is the applicant pays for the peer review.
That is correct. That's under the rules.
Dan from Down Cape Engineering, I would just, one thing that you might think about is having Mr. Bennett come in, who's very knowledgeable, and just say a few words to the board, questions and answers. That might be
the whole point. I think that's a good idea to have him come in anyway. But
well, and I think that might be one way to resolve it if the board felt. But I would just put out there that we limited his scope, or it's my understanding he was kind of focused on this site. The plume is a big issue, and I've seen a lot of paperwork, and it's not really affecting this site. So if we could limit any peer review to as it affects this site, it will keep everyone's costs down. It is a nonprofit, and if we have to pay
right, we're
for
not
it,
trying to review the impact
thing, yeah.
of you know everything from here to the Herring River. But I think we have to take the four corners of what he submitted and know. I mean, if he peer review came back and said the methodology is flawed, that the scope is not adequate under industry standards, we'd have to then go back to you and say, look, we think Mr. Bennett needs to go out and broaden the scope. If he says we're happy, it's fine, that certainly puts our, you know, it takes it off us. We're not environmental engineers. We shouldn't be trying to make an evaluation of, I mean, there's hundreds of soil analysis here and so forth that, you know, it's nice to give us this. You might as well give us Greek. We don't know what they mean.
I think we owe that to
the public was
raised.
Yeah, and we did, just to add, you know, the question came up on the PERC tests, and I'm very familiar with the soils on the site. We spent a lot of Habitat's effort on doing soil evaluations on the east side and on the west side, and I did an auger hole in the northwest corner and the southwest corner. And the reason for that was to determine exactly the tip of the groundwater table to see which way it was flowing, and also just to make sure, absolutely sure, we knew exactly how far below grade the water mm-hmm. table was, and to make sure that the septic systems would all work adequately. So normally that's probably not done for preliminary plans for 40B, but just to assure the board, we did spend quite a bit of time looking at the soils.
I don't think we'd be inclined to review something that's under Title V. You know, planning, if it meets Title V, you know, that's the standard. I don't think we need to peer review septic systems. We already have a standard, you know, a process for that. But this issue of the plume, I think, is important. And as I said, these peer reviews tend to hold up approvals of these things. That's why I thought we should get it going now rather than later, because we have to get a contractor on board, give us an RFP, engage someone. You've got to see it and say, okay.
So how do we proceed on this?
Well, staff,
we have to do a motion now, but then what happens?
Well, I think the first thing we do is, I don't think we need to do a motion right now, is staff needs to talk with the town offices about what consultants are available on staff, if any, on contract, rather, to provide environmental review services. If there are not, then I'm sure the town manager's office will indicate that you're going to have to go through an RFP process to obtain proposals for environmental review. I just don't know what they keep on, you know, some towns have open contracts for this kind of thing that are available, so we can immediately provide you with a proposal from
right.
somebody who's on contract.
And what we're looking at is Exhibit W.
Correct.
I think the difficulty may be that the town had hired Bennett previously.
typically the same environmental, what happens is in these kind of things is the same group of people keep reviewing each other's reports. It's not, I understand that, it's the nature of the beast. But
no, we very much appreciate the board's diligence in making sure that this is the best neighborhood can make it.
I think it's the best
you.
For everybody here. Then there's no second quit guessing about that issue. Let's get it done.
That's exactly why we got the study in the first place, was to make sure we felt comfortable with the site.
And we appreciate that.
Yeah, good.
That's helpful, because as John points out, there was a lot of discussion, a lot of concern on the plume, and it doesn't, it appears to be an issue, but not with respect to the site, but we just want to confirm that the study actually did what it should do to see if there was any problem.
I don't think we have to take a motion, Mr. Chairman. I think we can have staff work on this and communicate directly with you outside the meeting on the process, and then as rapidly as we can get a proposal to you so you can review and approve, and then get that going in the pipeline, because as I say, those tend to hold things up.
Okay.
That's all I got on that.
Thank you. Does the board have anything further at this point? Does the applicant or Heck have anything further at this point? Okay, I will then open it up to the public, but we've had a lot of discussion last time. We've had a lot of correspondence, so I'd like to request that people only address new points, any new information. The record has already got all the comments on it from the prior session and all the written comments, so I'd like not to go through those again, please. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, Lou Urbano from West Harwich. This question probably should be directed at Attorney Reed, but I'll bring it up here just so everybody might be able to think about it. The community, as I know, and I could be wrong, is interested in 97. The other house has no interest to us at all. It is 97 that has historical significance. So point number one is, if any state monies are to be used, we'd like to know, because that sets in another Section 6, I believe it's called, 106, that's a review that's done in terms of what should happen to the house and so forth, and even to the land. So that's a question, again, that will be addressed to Attorney Reed. Just would like you to think about it. The second question, and I'm confused by this because I really don't understand the site control as it's done today, and I know that Attorney Reed has more information, and I don't know if I'm in a position where I can share what he told me, so we'll leave that part out. But just in terms of right now, Habitat will have control, if I understand correctly.
Not been established yet.
Right. We expect that to happen. We also know that the 97 property has some units in it that may be not permitted. The question then becomes, at least in my mind, because we've been told since this project started that in order to bring 97 up to code, it would take somewhere in the range of $425,000. And so if that's not in code, and again, this may not be a question for you, then does that figure need to enter into the total project cost? And if that figure, any portion of a figure enters into the project cost, does then the application have to be resubmitted? Because I noticed there was a desire to keep the cost the same, so I assume that's all part of keeping everything the same. But yet there will be additional cost. I know this is complicated, forgive me. I don't even know if I have it straight in my own head. But if that house has to be brought to standard or to code, even afterwards, it's increasing the cost. And where's that in all this? So that's a question I have. And again, I'll get further. The second I was asked by Attorney Reed, if it would be okay if he came to the next one. I guess you're not gonna make a choice tonight. So the question would be redundant. I thank you for your time on those two questions, though.
Does either the applicant or Heck want to respond to that at this point?
From Hedge's point of view, just listen to the comments so we can take the information in and then review it.
Okay. That's fine.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, if you could.
Good evening, Duncan Berry from West Harwich.
I'd like to give you your address, please. Mr. Berry?
Beg pardon?
Would you remove your
thing? I didn't even know that I had it so on.
And give us your address.
Address is 37 Route 28 in West Harwich. Duncan Berry. I'd like to address item number 26 and item number 25. Item number 26 has to do with the idea of a sidewalk. I believe that's already been taken care of by Mass DOT. They're have a comprehensive plan that's already underway, and the location and the sizing and what have you of the sidewalk areas already in play. So I think it's kind of.
I'm sorry, what are you referring to? Item 25?
26.
Of what?
Of the
your
last.
Conditions? The
conditions that we were just discussing.
Of the conditions?
Yeah. Yeah. But it had to do with the sidewalk?
It was the stop sign condition.
It has to do with the stop sign.
It was at Ms. that point.
Ms.
Muller
pointed out.
There was a comment. It's not in the document. There was a comment at that point about a crosswalk.
A crosswalk.
It's not
a sidewalk.
It's not in this document.
Okay.
Anyway, I think whatever is owned by the state, that's going to be taken care of, and up to including, you know, 3 feet beyond the road point or vector, I guess, goes beyond that. So it's something that's already going to be perhaps already taken care of. Item 25 has to do with, I think, Mr. Burke's excellent point that this is a potential Pyrrhic victory for those of us who are interested in the historic preservation of the area. By overshooting the mark with a very stringent application of a preservation restriction. As you may know, we are pursuing a National Register historic districting, which is the least restrictive. This building qualifies as having a listing on the National Register. Having a listing on the National Register does not involve any kind of accommodation to any kind of code. You can even demolish one. And what it does do is it provides an incentive for the interested owner to avail him or herself of tax credits and I believe credits against purchase for materials and labor to pursue preservation work. So instead of demanding a certain kind of standard of preservation, perhaps just requesting that they participate with the rest of the group in the district in this national preservation, the national registry would be in much less onerous, much less expensive, and a better incentive that will probably and hopefully obviate the kind of circumstance that you pointed out. You know, you make it impossible for somebody to do it because it's so expensive.
Well, if we don't have this, whatever item it was there.
25
in, they can demolish it. Okay, because.
Correct, you can demolish it when.
The demolition bylaw delay has already passed.
That's correct.
And they're agreeing to preserve the exterior, and we want them to do that.
Right, but our point was that the condition that's probably the most beneficial to a future owner isn't something that would be restrictive to Mass Historical, but National Trust. And they're already pursuing that. So then,
you know, that might be, but it's not here today. What we would have here today, though, is this restriction which will not let them take it down. They have to preserve the exterior, and whatever happens in the future with respect to a historic district, that can be addressed at that point in time. The structure will remain.
Okay, fair enough. Thanks.
But thank you for your comments. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Gail McAleer, 103 Main Street, Route 28, right next door to the property in question. I just, thinking about this concept of how this conveyance is being proposed to occur, I'm having trouble seeing how this does not set a precedent for completely bypassing zoning throughout the entire Commonwealth. I mean, if this is acceptable, then conceivably someone would say a 30,000 square foot lot with a single family home on it could subdivide it, do a 40B application, subdivide it, put multiple, one cottage perhaps, a cottage, multiple homes in their backyard, convey it back to themselves immediately, and have their single family home and their granny in the backyard, or their multi-family in the backyard, and no fuss, no muss. I mean, completely gets around zoning very easily.
That's not how 40B works. I mean, there's a whole process that has to be gone through and standards met under 40B,
right,
to get the applicable, applicability letter.
Mm.
So, no, that's not a correct statement, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
If an applicant meets the standards of 40B, they can then subdivide the lot as the applicant here has proposed, but subject to certain restrictions like affordability and, you know, the market rate up to 70% local community. So it's not like a developer can come in and subdivide it and then sell them for $1 million each. That's not the way it works, if that was your point. Yes, would anyone else like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Ann Stewart, Pleasant Lake. I just wanted to discuss the idea of the rental units that are there right now in the main house. I understand that you could perhaps override the fact that, or maybe grandfather in the zoning requirement that it's not multifamily, it could be okay multifamily going forward. But I'm wondering about how safe those units are. A few years ago, maybe it was a year and a half ago, I can't exactly remember, but at a historic meeting, it was discussed, there was conversation back and forth about the demolition, whether they could have an extension about the demolition. And the young woman that was representing Hatch didn't have any records or documentation of any maintenance that they had done for their rental houses. And there was some comment that the place had been neglected, that they were not being taken care of. And I would think that going forward, if this is all approved, that those rental units should have to accommodate current building codes, you know, the plumbing, the electrical, everything having the insulation. That should be compliant with our local building codes. They shouldn't be just going on indefinitely with, you know, inadequate maintenance. And one of the reasons is even if some random people end up owning 97 and 93, and it's, you know, market rate, it's just not, it shouldn't be just random maintenance and accountability to building codes, because those two are the entrance to this whole development. And if they are neglected and they're not, you know, properly, they don't meet fire requirements and everything, then that's the gateway to this whole big development. So those places should be inspected. They should have to comply with any appropriate building codes and requirements that we would have to have for rental housing. Thank you.
I will let Heck address that question when they're ready.
I have something on that too.
Anyone else?
Good evening. Got to put my glasses on so I can see all my little notes. My name is Darian Davis. I live on Willow Street in West Harwich. And to back up what Ann was suggesting and talking about, I believe I'm a little confused that there's a buyer for the two houses that are in the front, and then they're going to sell it back to Hesh or something for a dollar. What was that about?
I'm going to let the applicant explain that.
In 20 words or less.
Habitat and Hatch together are working to try to preserve those houses based on community and town input. The creative, and some might say complex, way we have chosen to keep those houses instead of demolishing them is that Habitat will buy the entire property, so we have site control. We then deed back the smaller front lots to Hatch. Hatch does have a buyer, but that's their relationship with the buyer. So Habitat is buying the entire property and then selling the front smaller lots back to Hatch. We are doing this in order to try to preserve those homes.
So Hetch will once again be the landlords of those two front properties, is that correct?
Only until they sell the property, and then whoever the ultimate end owner of the property will be the landlord.
Okay, so right now, from what I understand, there's mold and repairs that needed to be made in at least one, if not two, of the houses. And to me, it looks like at the moment, Hesh is not a very good landlord. They're not very hands-on. When you drive by, specifically one of the houses does not look enticing at all, either to be a renter or a landlord. And if the outside doesn't look good, I can only imagine what the inside looks. And I believe you also said that one of the houses had units that were not permitted. Have they ever been inspected? Have they ever had a CO done? Do they have fire and smoke alarms? Are we putting those, quote, tenants at risk for having an unauthorized rental? And who's responsible for that? Whether they were purchased 10 years ago, you must be able to go back to that person through town records to find out what they did, and did anyone inspect it at all? Or is it just a fire trap waiting to happen? Thank you.
I'm going to let
If I could respond to that, I'm not getting into too much detail, but other than to say that Hetch has been around for a long, long time. They've done many developments in the town. They have an in-house maintenance department. They take care of their properties. And I'm not going to go further into, you know, their abilities as a landlord. However, they have an excellent reputation, and that's my response.
I think there have been enough current questions about the current conditions of that house that reassurance does not reassure me.
And that's fine. There is, and Ladara and I are probably becoming a broken record, and I apologize for that, but there is a very, very simple way to resolve all of these concerns. We remove the structures and we propose the same new. That will eliminate, and I'm just saying that, we're doing this, everyone's trying to bend over backwards to save the structures. If it can't be done, we gave it the college try. We're doing our best. But if the board ultimately feels that those are issues that they can't get over, the project can be revised to demolish the structures and rebuild.
You know, I took sales training years ago, and I think I remember that would come under the heading of what was then called the impending doom close. If you raise questions about this house, we'll take it down. I'd like to know. I think it should meet all the current requirements, regardless of this application.
And I'm not saying it won't. It's up to, that's a separate review with the town. Not you, but the town department. I mean,
this was the first concept that we came up with. Was, you know, let's look at that. We had this idea for Habitat has a home plan that is a duplex style home that we thought would fit nicely on the 28 facade. We were thinking of two duplexes. We were thinking of a cul-de-sac down the middle of the two. And then I believe it was eight homes around the cul-de-sac, 8, 9, 10, for 12 homes. And that was originally what we thought. We came up with this more creative idea to try to meet the requests of the community.
Having hearkened repeatedly to your stellar reputations, I would think you'd be eager to assure us that, in fact, 97 has only legally permitted units and that it meets all currently applicable codes. I have to say, going there, I've not been impressed to see a handwritten sign scratched on the outside staircase about not using this. It doesn't give one confidence in the safety of that building. And when you refer to the subsequent owner after the H2B new owner transfer, I think we all need to keep in mind that this new owner, prospective new owner in the future, really could walk at any point, that Hesh could, in theory, be the owner of that property for a long time if this goes forward. Thank you.
If you just hold on 1 minute, Mr. Burke had a comment before we
Well, I was just going to, this is actually something I wanted to bring up at the end here. As the public may be aware, Mr. Attorney Reed has sent a letter questioning the legality of the use in the larger building 97. And we talked, we've kind of touched on this issue in other areas, on the control issue and so forth. And I think since it goes to the heart of some of the relief we'd be granting, we should come to a conclusion about what is the status of the use. And I think the appropriate way to do that is the building inspector, the building commissioner, is the zoning enforcement officer by statute, and we should ask him to review the town records and opine to us as to whether or not the uses currently located there are completely legal, partially legal, whatever they are, rather than us trying to come to a conclusion about it, and at the same time make a physical inspection of the property to tell us to what extent those uses conform to code.
All right, Charlie.
Or the history gives us that.
Well, I don't think that'll do it. History's too ancient. I think that Mr. Burke's point is well taken. Shayla, will you take care of that with our building inspector, please?
So that perhaps by the next meeting he could give us a letter,
right,
indicating that he's made. So there's two issues: make a physical inspection of the property to determine code compliance, and second, to give us his opinion about the legality of the current uses. Are they pre-existing, non-conforming, legally, or two-family?
I know for a fact that it's difficult to make a determination as to code compliance when you can't see behind the walls.
I'm assuming you provide him access to the building inspector?
Well, you see what I'm saying? They generally do not do those things.
I understand the limit, yeah, but I mean, I'm presuming Heck will provide the building inspector with that. He has the right anyway, but I mean.
Yeah, we'll work with their tenants. Just have to work around tenants.
We understand that he may not be able to do certain invasive things, but to the extent that he can make an observation. I think that's helpful for both of us to, you know, obviously crafting the relief be helpful if we know what the answer to the issue is. And that would, I think, put that to rest, or help us to anyway.
Yeah, and I just, a general observation, when you buy a property, you or I, any of us, you don't have to bring it up to code. The existing code, whatever it was built with and whatever was done at the time, assuming it was then compliant with code, carries on. So right. I just want the public to be aware of that. You know, when you buy your house, you don't have the inspector come in and upgrade your electricity because the code's changed. That's completely different, ma'am. Completely different. What I'm talking about is bringing up to current code. Probably very few homes that, you know, that exist today comply with current code. Because the code is ever changing and evolving. So I say that so everybody understands that.
So is that okay then?
Yes, that's a good idea. I agree. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. I'm Ginny Hewitt. I live at 787 Main Street in Harwich Center. I submitted a letter to the board supporting this project and talking about the critical need in the community for affordable housing. So I won't go over all those points again. But as someone who values and advocates for historic preservation, my concern is that if arrangements aren't made to allow this arrangement to go through the way that they've described it tonight, then Hetch could just demolish the two existing homes, including the one historic home. And I don't think that would certainly decrease the density and resolve some of the other concerns, but I don't think that's what the people working for the preservation of West Harwich want to happen. So I would support Mr. Berry's suggestion that not as strong a historic preservation restriction as what they proposed tonight be applied. In fact, this building, since it is more than 100 years old, is already protected and would fall. Any changes would have to come under the historic district, go to the historic district. The historical commission would have any, already has some role in reviewing work that's done there. Anyway, I just wanted to say, I looked at the drawings that, you know, it's great that all the information's on the website, you know, with the meeting agenda. I looked at the drawings of the homes that are proposed, and they're just lovely. They're not boxes. There's a lot of nice detail. They fit in very well with the character of the community. I was really impressed to see just how lovely the homes were. And I think Mrs. Zola talked about that Habitat's in the business of building homes and not just building houses. And I also think with the smaller lots that have been discussed, I like that. I think that builds a neighborhood. My home is probably 14,000 square foot lot, and really, I'd like to give some of that up. Maintaining that is not my favorite thing. So anyway, I think, but I like a neighborhood. I like being right. I'm right in Harwich Center. I like that. I like a walking neighborhood. I like to know my neighbors. Yeah, unfortunately, I'm on Main Street, so I'm actually part of a subdivision that's behind me, and I'm not really considered part of that, apparently, because I'm not part of the Homeowners Association. And I wish I was, because I think that's what builds community, and that's what we want in town. We want to be a thriving, vibrant, and a sustainable community, and we're not going to be sustainable if we don't have affordable housing. And I think all the time about moving off Cape, because I need to be able to retire at some point. If I move somewhere where there's more variety in the housing stock, I would have that option. Anyway, I think Habitat has an excellent reputation. They've tried to work with everyone in good faith, and if that's not possible, then I think they should go ahead and proceed to what they would legally be allowed to do. I think this is an excellent project, and we need this in town. So thank you.
Thank you. There seems to be some confusion about the preservation restriction. Okay. Hetch, the applicant and Hetch have represented that they've already gone through the Harwich Historical Commission demolition delay, 365 days, so they're clear. So tomorrow they could go out and knock that house down. They've agreed to put a restriction on, and I think we need that to preserve it. If we don't have that in as a condition, they sell it, the subsequent owner can take it down. And the fact that you're trying to get it on the registry isn't going to affect that, because you don't have that district established. So that's why I put it in as a condition. I think that's the only way at this point in time, if the permit's granted, you're going to have the exterior of the Judah Chase house and barn preserved. So I think we need that. So just everybody
should
understand
that. I guess my point was that there are some people saying that preservation restriction is not enough and it doesn't satisfy them. And I'm saying the alternative is this project doesn't go forward as proposed, and the affordable housing entities could come back with a different proposal which does not include preserving the homes. And that was my point.
Right, but I'm just saying some of the other points, people thought we didn't need that. That's what I gathered, and I think we do need it.
Well, I think it's great. I think it's great how they've tried to act in good faith and work with the community and preserve that community character.
Right. And Hetch has agreed to put that in voluntarily. They weren't required to. So, yes, sir.
Ralph Diamond from 103 Route 28 in West Harwich. Thank you for putting that restriction. I think it's very important. I think it would go a long way in answering a lot of questions if the prospective buyer or representative for the prospective buyer of the property came in, and so that we all knew that he was going into this project with his eyes wide open. I actually suspect he is. Maybe it's a local person. I suspect it is. But I think that would answer a lot of questions. If we knew going forward that this buyer knew what needed to be done to satisfy code and to satisfy the historic preservation that we're asking for, I think that would help a lot. And I was just wondering if Attorney Singer might know, or if somebody from Hitch might know, whether that person or a representative for that person would be willing to come in and talk to us a little bit about that.
I can certainly ask.
And that's all that can be. We can't bring that person in. We don't have that ability to bring them in. But Attorney Singer said they will ask him or her. Yes, ma'am.
Gail McAleer again. Just one quick point on the historical. I was just curious. I know that the selectmen have offered or voted to give $300,000 to Habitat for the purchase of the land, the back portion of the property for the six houses. And I don't know if there was some condition on that money regarding the preservation of the Judah Chase house. I think also there was some proposal for, there was also going to be a request of funds for another $300,000 or $350,000 from, I think, CPA funds to actually construct the homes as well. So there's quite a bit of taxpayer money that is being invested in this project as well. I'm not quite sure whether or not there's any stipulation in the offer of taxpayer money to preserve this property as well. Perhaps that could be researched also, or someone might have an answer to that question. Thank you.
I tried to find out the answer through some of the minutes of those sessions of the selectmen, and I don't remember now if it was Habitat or Heck or jointly, they agreed with the selectmen to put the preservation restriction on, and they're doing that. They've not objected to that condition. In fact, they've talked about it throughout this application hearing that they're willing to do it. So that's really kind of a non-issue. They've agreed to do it, and they're willing to do it. And we will get it on the land record, so then whoever buys it is taking subject to that restriction.
Mr. Chair, did you say willing to do it or required to do it?
Well, both, because I propose it as a condition, so it will be a condition of the permit, but they weren't required to even do it at the selectmen's meeting. They agreed to do it because there was community interest in preserving it, and they were asking for taxpayer money, and as part of their presentation, they agreed to preserve that because there were concerns expressed by the community. Was my reading of the minutes.
Lou Urbano again, just one question on that. If the house was to be demolished, then I would assume the whole process would go back to the selectmen and start from the beginning because of the $300,000 that was given to start this project. So that demolition thing, the demolition close, might not be as
available.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
I don't know. I have no comment on that. I have no idea. My reading of the minutes is it was not a condition of the grant of money. But what was, you know.
It was voluntarily offered.
It was voluntarily
by
made, and the selectmen accepted it. So
correct.
I guess there's an implied condition, but they did not make it a quid pro quo of getting the money. So the minutes were kind of sparse, but that's my reading of them. Okay, if there's nothing further from the public, I think.
I got one other comment.
We will go back to the board.
I think as far as the Chase House is concerned, I think it's pretty much agreed, both sides of the argument, that the Chase House with the three apartments in it, or three units, essentially is not allowed by the zone that they're in. Therefore, when we make a request for the department to look at not only the condition of the apartments or the units, et cetera, but he's got to have to come back and say, do you need a special permit or not, or do you need a waiver? With three units, I think they need a variance. With two units, they need a special permit, which they don't have. But that's the kind of question I think we need answered by a planning board or the inspector. We need to get that answer, not from legal, because I don't think it's a legal issue at this point. I think it's a zoning issue, planning board and inspector issue. And we need to get his comments. Because I think the basis of what I just said, is that correct? I don't have, if the applicant would like to comment on that, am I correct in what I stated? That the three units are illegal, but two units would be require a special permit.
I can't speak to that. What I can speak to is your question about the building commissioner looking at whether it's a special permit, a variance, or a waiver.
Right.
Whatever would otherwise normally be required, special permit, variance, whatever, what
would happen under the 40B, and let him look at this, what would happen under the 40B is that Ladara would add it as a waiver of use from the zoning bylaw. It's not a special permit. It's not a variance. It would be another one of the waivers on that list you have under the comprehensive permit.
Exactly. We would have to be granting it here where it was not granted before.
Correct.
Correct.
I understand that. Right. That's what I want the answer, the question
right.
answer.
Right.
Yeah,
I agree with you.
For how many units does Hesh receive rent checks every month?
There are five, on the two properties,
no,
there are five units.
Just 97.
Three units.
No, 93 also.
Well, yeah, she said there are three units on 97 and two units on 93 right now.
I put on the barn, it's one dwelling unit in the cottage and three in the main house.
Correct. We're asking, again, a lot of this interlap.
No, I don't want to hear any more from the public tonight, ma'am. Thank you. You had your opportunity.
The barn is not occupied at the moment, is why some of the confusion on units. So the ranch home on 93 Main Street has two units.
Question on the status of the
The Chase home on 97 has three units.
Exclusive of the barn.
And then the barn has an additional unit for a total of six units.
And the barn unit is proposed. The three in the Chase house are existing.
Okay, thank you.
And which would be interesting because I think the barn has a bedroom but no heat, and it's called a unit, and I kind of go, that's interesting.
I asked Hetch about that because it was Attorney Reed raised it. There, and I noted that there is evidence that there was dwelling capacity in that structure. It hasn't been used for a long, long time. I don't think Hetch has ever used it. But just, so that's just what we pointed out, and that's why Dan had it on the plan.
But 97, the house, is now
three.
Multi-family housing, not two-family housing.
Correct, and it's been three families since before Hetch bought it.
So 93 would require a variance because it's got two, and 97 would require either a variance if they reduced it to two, or a waiver, or
it would be a waiver under the 40B permit.
Right. Waiver under the 40B, but from a zoning standpoint of view, it would be a
special permit on the two-family, variance on the three-family.
Right.
Mr. Burke.
A couple quick questions. On the issue that this unit in the barn, then, is it possible this use has been abandoned?
Go ahead.
I believe that what we are looking at is prospective. And what we are seeking is a waiver from use to use a 40B
permit. We'll let the building inspector, I guess.
Okay. Yeah, and so in a way, I mean, I think it's very good of this board to really dig into the details. But in the future, the request before
Okay, as long as that's in the
okay, so you're going to amend your waivers.
Yeah, you need to amend the waivers to get this all in here because it's not in here. Another quick question for Mr. Rojala, the RDA, what's the status of that? Is that filed?
Yes, at the request of them, we just delay it until after this process, but that has been filed and it's been continued twice.
You anticipate just a negative determination on it?
Yeah, we would because it's flood zone only, all the buildings comply, there's no real performance standards for flood zone, so it should be routine.
Pretty straightforward, okay, so we don't have to really worry too much about.
No, in my opinion, no, but it is out there. I don't think the 40B can waive the Wetlands Protection Act, so we have to file.
Is that process going to be wrapped up soon, do you think, or is that?
We were just asked to delay it until after we had the public opinion of this, figured we'd vet it in one forum, and then once it had been granted, would finish with that board. So that was the plan.
You just keep us apprised to it.
Okay.
Yeah, good. All right. Absolutely. I just wondered if it was filed already. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. But just continued twice.
Okay, great.
Thank you. For this evening, anything further from the applicant?
Had enough.
Thank you for your patience with, the complexity and creativity, but again, the comment that we are doing this to try to meet all the various interests and that we're not trying to obfuscate any kind of ownership trail. We have the ownership, and that is why we wanted to keep it to Hetch, giving it back to them, and that the site control is there. and that what we feel we are doing is a benefit to the community. I mean, we also, we've been talking about a lot of things, but we'd like to remind this board about the 6 homes that will be created, that will be deed restricted, affordable for Harwich in perpetuity. Thank you.
Appreciate the openness.
Yeah,
thank you.
In light of that, I'll withdraw my comments about shell game and smell.
We also appreciate your openness. And
anything further from Hatch?
Not tonight, thank you.
Okay, I will entertain a motion to continue this case to 7 o'clock as our first case at our regular meeting on April 26th, Wednesday, April 26th.
I will second that motion.
No, you're going to make the motion.
Oh. Through you, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion. We continue this hearing on a regular scheduled meeting, and it will be the first part
first
of the hearing.
At 7. Mm-hmm.
The first hearing on the 26th of April 2017 at 0700 at night.
I'm sorry, I have a commitment on that evening. Do we have another choice? I am sorry, this is an out-of-town commitment.
We do not have another choice at this time.
Okay, then you don't get me.
1900 hours, I'm sorry.
1900, yeah, not 0700, yeah. We do not have another choice.
Fine, I just.
Except for the end of May.
Then we'd have to convene another meeting to. So I would say let's leave it at the 26th. Can I have a second for the motion?
I'll second it.
Okay, Mr. Burke and Ms. Muller. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Nobody? Aye. Aye.
Aye.
Okay, I will entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second it.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Adjourned.